Hi, it's Louisa Dahl. And welcome to the Interactive Minds podcast, where I talk with passionate marketers, innovators, and digital leaders about their specific recipes for success. In today's show, I interview digital expert Rob Hudson, talking about how he started his own consulting company after an agency career. Here's three things you're going to learn. One, how Rob made the move and where his clients come from. Two, the concept of payment based on outcomes. And three, Rob's advice for new consultants. Let's get into it. Today I'm here with Rob Hudson, digital guru, strategy, advertising, marketing and innovation expert and the founder of Spout Logic. Rob is a long-term friend of mine and of Interactive Minds. Indeed, he's been our MC at the Digital Summit for the last 7 years and also been involved as a mentor, speaker and lots more over the years. It's great to have you here today. Welcome, Rob.
Thank you very much for having us. It's already been 7 years. Good Lord.
I know. Scary, isn't it? This year would have been the eighth. So,
wow.
Yes, very scary. Now, I've given you a bit of an intro there, Rob, but how do you describe what you do to other people?
Oh, badly, usually. I guess I've been doing marketing, advertising, something in that realm for the last like 28 years, which kind of gives you a sense of how old I am. And it's always been digital for the last 25 years. So, like, I guess what we do as a business is help people on that digital journey, which is ridiculous. I mean, it's a ridiculous term in the modern era, right? But it still exists, so let's use it. But yep. we kind of help people from right the way back into the world of strategy and gathering new data in new ways, right the way through to then applying that data into strategies, and then, you know, execution. Like, what does it look like when the rubber hits the road? How do we take that into the real space? So it's a very interesting space for us because we get to do what we want to do, really. We have a lot of fun doing lots of different things. And to certain clients, we're only known for one of those aspects. And on a couple of occasions, clients know us for all of those things. So we get to have a good bit of fun.
And digital is so broad now. I mean, every year it gets broader and broader, doesn't it? So saying you do it all is, you know, tricky in some levels.
Digital's eventually we're going to have to drop the term, right? Because is this a digital campaign? Well, point to me the thing that you're going to do in your campaign that's not digital. Mm. You know, and eventually they end up sort of doing a whole load of out of home. It's just like, that's probably more digital than anything these days, you know, with targeting and triggers and all sorts of stuff. So, yeah, it's a dubious term, but it's one we kind of have to hold on to until the world is caught up, I suppose.
That's true. Now, you've spent a large portion of your career in advertising agencies, most recently as the MD of Clemenger in Brisbane and before that at YNR. Looking back over your career over these last 28 years, what stands out to you as some highlights?
Oh, God. For me, what advertising agency life offers is diversity. We've done some crazy stuff. I did a public inquiry for the Defence Force. I've done a whole load of stuff where we've kind of got to go into different countries. Back in the UK versions of it, I did roadshows around the whole of Europe, you know, and just that diversity. Mm-hmm. Like the fact that we have to learn and understand to a degree, not to the level of clients, of course, but we get to learn so many different industries and so many different verticals. Like the stories are endless, like just some of this crazy stuff we get to do. And, you know, it's not. And of course, when you're telling a story about looking back 25 years, you tell all the highlights. And then, of course, there's just the occasional very late nights and just smashing out campaigns. There's no doubt about that. But the fact that we get to do that and get to work with so many different people in so many different ways has always been the thing that makes that industry exciting, to be honest.
Yeah, definitely. That makes sense. So what are you doing now since you've left that kind of big agency world?
Well, I guess I've kind of, the intent was to go upstream a little bit. So rather than just the executional side of things, which, you know, falls into that advertising bracket, what I really wanted to do, and I think we've achieved it, is to help become more of a partner to the clients and get more into the marketing aspect of things and to apply all the things I've learned at the advertising end and see how that moves up into the kind of boardroom decision making and how we pay that part. We've certainly seen a shift in where marketing sits in boardrooms across most clients. So it was really a case of kind of wanting to get to a really good understanding of what that now looks like and how can we apply the knowledge, the way we do things, the kind of skill sets that we've had for decades. We probably have given them new names now, but we already had those skills. So things like we do a lot of customer journey modeling. Mm. But we always kind of understood that with insights and structure. We just now formalize it a bit more, and it's obviously a lot more digitally led than it ever has been. There's so much more data now, helping clients really make use of that data. So kind of take what we've learned from the advertising world and just go a little bit more into the client side of things. And deliver on that promise that agencies so often say but struggle to deliver, which is to become a partner to clients. And I certainly find myself sat at board level more often than not now, talking to boards about how they can do things. And that starts to fulfill that need to kind of want to be a bit further into the food chain.
Yes. As I've been talking to marketers over the last kind of 12 months, I've seen an increase in people who are moving from a more corporate role to more of a consultant or micro agency role, whatever you might call the term. What made you take the step and to stay in this space?
I think it was something that just felt right. You know, when you're looking at the marketplace, when you're kind of listening to clients, and when you're in agency world, you're pitching constantly. So you do get a really good understanding of what clients are after. And then struggling a little bit to use the old agency model to deliver to that new need. And also seeing clients outpace us. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean, there were occasions where we would go in and talk about what we wanted to do in terms of digital strategy and digital execution. And they were ahead of us. They were bringing in MarTech well ahead of agencies.
Yeah.
And the kind of feeling like if you don't change tack a little bit, you're going to be a dinosaur pretty quick. So just that want to get out and try and be a little bit more at the cutting edge.
Yeah,
that's not oxymoron. But yeah, I think that's kind of essential.
Mm. And what do you find the main difference day to day now between working in those big agencies versus doing what you're doing now? And what should we call that? I mean, I know we've had this discussion before and there's not one correct term for that.
But I struggle with it. Like micro, yeah. I guess at the end of the only term we've ever found that sort of fits is that we're consultants.
Yep.
But that obviously comes with, people put their own meaning on that word. But in reality, that's what we're doing. We're consulting with clients and helping them through.
Yes.
And this business ranges from, days when it'll be like me and a couple of other people. At the moment, I think it's me and we've got 14, 15 people contracted at the moment, so it's a reasonable size.
Yeah, it's a big team
business in that return. So I think that's what makes it really interesting for us. We can also go and get the right people for the right job. Just taking on a medical client, and of course that's a very skilled copywriting exercise. It's a very skilled knowledge set. So we just go out to market and find ourselves a pharmaceutical writer. You can't really do that in agency life. You've got to fulfill the team you have. And I think that flexibility has been wonderful, really. So what do we call ourselves? A consultant, marketing architects, I think has been kicked around a couple of times, if that's not precocious. Probably is, but and I think that it fits to whatever it needs to be. Of course, we've got some clients that only buy the research part of what we do, and they don't consider us marketers at all. They consider us kind of technical researchers. I think when you're a consultant, you get to be a little bit adaptive.
Yes, that's right.
Agile, but we get to, fit the need of the client, let's call it that.
And did you have the need for this, contractors, if you want to call them that, to work on projects with you from day one, or is that something that's grown as time has gone on?
Well, it's certainly grown, no doubt about it. Like, I think day one, we probably had two or three people doing bits and pieces for us, but certainly now it's now a full-time exercise. There hasn't been in the last 6 months of time where we haven't had somebody working for us somewhere. And it's an interesting one, because the question always then comes like, are you going to scale the business? You can start, building up a big business with people that you employ. And I think that diversity gives us the challenge.
Yes.
Yeah, it's come up a couple of times, like people asking that question if we're going to employ people.
Yeah.
And in reality, I wouldn't quite know where to begin to find the one person we need all the time. And I think that's interesting in itself. So yeah, look, that lots of partnerships. Again, the joy of being on your own is that you can build partnerships and relationships. And we're now on supplier boards with we've been out to a few software companies and used their software, and then within like a month we're then on their list of people that they're putting forward to their customers. So you get to build these great relationships and networks that you could never do any other business.
Nice. I guess one thing with growth is team size and managing people. Do you spend more or less time managing people now than you would have in agency world?
Oh, so much less. So much less now. I mean, in reality, when you're a managing director of a business, as I was with Clemenger, you're managing the business. Yes, you have relationships with clients, and yes, you have relationships in terms of doing work and all that sort of stuff. But in reality, you're running the business. And therefore, it's all people.
Yes.
You know, agencies are effectively, there's not a great deal of infrastructure to an agency. It's a lot of computers and a desk. You know, that's pretty much it.
Yeah.
What you're really managing is the relationships and the people and how they interact with each other. So, yeah, that has diminished greatly now that I'm kind of, contractors are much easier, it turns out.
Fantastic. Awesome. Now, what about long-term vision? Is that something you spend a lot of time on now, or do you find you don't kind of have to stop and think too far ahead? You just kind of work on projects and clients as they come in? And is that different to kind of corporate world?
Yeah, like vision's a really interesting one. You know, I think when you start a small business, as we were, you kind of, vision's a luxury sometimes. You know what you want to do, but you've also got to meet the market. You've got to be able to deliver what the customers are after. So we certainly left ourselves very agile for the first sort of 6 to 8 months. I think now we've definitely found our stride. We know what we're good at, and we're kind of doing our best to be consistent around that. I think we also have the luxury now of doing stuff that's interesting, which means we can be a bit more adaptive. If something comes along that you're going to go, well, look, it's not wonderfully profitable, but it gives us new capabilities or challenges us in new ways that we've never had before, that's definitely something we take on. So we've probably got 3 or 4 clients in that category where you kind of go, it's just really, really interesting work. And we're using new technologies or new softwares in ways that have never been done before. Like, yeah, okay, let's do that. And of course, what that does is enriches the business, makes it much more viable for the future because you have a handle on those things.
Yeah, and more fun as well, I presume, because you're getting to, you know, try some new stuff and make
Hell
it work.
Yeah. 100%. It's like, yeah, it's a real joy to do those projects sometimes.
Yeah.
But you can go, and they can be equally as scary when you're heading towards a deadline and you know, things aren't going the way they're supposed to with, you know, vendors or whatever. But, you know, today, thank God, we've never missed a deadline. We've never missed a target. We've always achieved what we're supposed to do for our clients. And in the middle of COVID, you know, that's
fantastic.
The extra challenges that brings as well. So, like, it's been a bit of a wonderful journey, really, in some respects.
And how do you find new customers now?
Look, I think network, you know, Brisbane has the advantage, you know, those two agencies you mentioned earlier with Y&R and with Clemenger both afforded me a quite a deep and meaningful network when I was there. So those networks are still delivering, you know, I'm still getting phone calls from people I haven't spoken to for 3 or 4 years who remember me in one way or another. Obviously, things like the Digital Summit also helped. You know, my profile is reasonably okay.
Yep.
So I think there's that. I think at the end of the day, if you get the product right, we've had a few clients come through just in the last couple of weeks who I've never had dealings with the individuals or the businesses.
Okay.
But they've spoken to other people who sort of said, "Oh, if you want that type of work, you know, these guys are delivering." And I think it's a small city. It kind of works well if you can pull it off that way.
So you would say mainly networks or referrals. Are you doing anything now to continue to nurture those networks? I mean, I know it's a difficult time. So what's your approach at this stage?
Well, things like this obviously help. Yeah. And thank you. So thank you.
sure.
Look, I think, yeah, you're right. It's been tricky. It's been very tricky over the last few periods to do this sort of things. You know, there's not so many meet and greets out there, right? I think it's attend what you can, you know, and be seen to be at what you can. I'm on a few boards, which means I also get to do the sort of networking with those boards. And again, they've struggled with exactly the same thing. You know, one's about an event and one's about an event space. So, you know, that's a challenging time. I think everybody just sort of dug in. I think most people is also at the moment are accepting of that, and I'm seeing a lot of people enter into a lot more kind of conversations and trying to keep their networks alive. LinkedIn has been crazy for me over the last, you know, 6 months.
Okay.
So many chats and conversations going on there. It's just been, you know, off the charts.
So is that a tool that you use more now than you used to?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, I think before it was about lead gen and data. So we would always pay for the premium and do that kind of lead gen data stuff. Now it's much more of an engagement platform. So it's, I'm part of the, I do quite a lot on the mentoring side of LinkedIn. You know, you get those kind of mentor things come through.
Yep.
So I actively participate in that because it's quite a nice way to give back. But also you meet some really interesting people with some really interesting challenges. So you can kind of help out quite quickly and easily on those.
Yeah. Do you find that you're thinking more about how you can market yourself and get out there now than you used to? Or is it similar? Or is that not something that you kind of spend too much time on?
It's difficult for me to say, isn't it? As someone who professes to be a marketing, we probably don't do anywhere near as much as we ought to be brutal.
Yeah.
I mean, we run the usual, we run, some SEM and we run some, ironically, we run some LinkedIn ads, but not a great deal, to be perfectly honest with you. We're kind of doing okay with just word of mouth and networking. So, that's not advice I'd give out, admittedly, but it seems to be working.
Yeah, fair enough. Whatever works, hey.
Yeah, well, exactly. And to be honest with you, even we don't have a lot of mouths to feed. It's not like we have to have a huge pipeline of business. So
yeah, that's right. Well, how do you keep yourself motivated, especially at the moment when we're all working a lot more solo than we used to be? Is there any tips or tricks that you use to keep yourself motivated and on target when you're working from home?
Yeah, I think keep that close network close. I've certainly got. 5 or 6 people, yourself included, that I would say are that inner sanctum of friends that we just get on phones and chat, and if there's a problem or a challenge in a particular piece of work or strategy, I do miss, there's no doubt about it, not being in agency, I miss the sticking my head over the top of my divider and talking to the people around me about problems and challenges.
Yes.
There's no doubt about that.
It's hard to replace that, isn't it?
Yeah, the cat's nowhere near as informative.
way less quality conversation.
I think we all have those people that you've worked with for a long time, that you know really well, that you can confide in and have conversations with about the realities and the challenges you're facing.
Yeah.
And on the whole, those conversations are nearly always reciprocated with, wonderful advice, and everybody's wanting to help at the moment.
Mm. Yes.
And that's been, a great outpouring of what we've seen around COVID is actually that, God, we're actually a group of people that actually just want to get on with it and actually can dig in and help each other. So,
yeah.
And equally, I've been doing the same thing, trying to help other people if they've asked and make sure you're available.
So. Yeah, definitely. Do you have many other people in your network who are also in this consulting kind of space?
Increasingly, yeah. Well, if you'd asked me that 6 months ago, I said no. But of course, over the last 6 months, yes, increasingly, because obviously a few of them have had little choice but to get into this space.
Yes.
Unfortunately. And then a few have made the decision that the time is right. So I'd say it's probably gone from 4 or 5 people I know in the Brisbane area, at least, I'd say at least 20, 25 now that are doing similar things.
Mm.
And then you find that everybody's got their little niche or their little way of approaching things. I've got a couple of people that do sort of corporate training and one particular group of guys that do Salesforce training,
okay.
as in the people that sell things, not as in the software.
Yeah, yep.
And they've been awesome because that actually fits beautifully with what we do. When we go in and talk about optimizing communication, they can roll in behind us and help optimize the actual, the phone incoming phone calls and stuff. So, partnerships like that, brilliant. And they're new to consulting as well. They've come out from the big corporate consultants.
Yes. So. Okay. Interesting. Do you think that this marks a change in how corporates are getting their digital strategy and execution done? The fact that now maybe there's more consultants out there that are perhaps having these big end of town as customers?
Yeah, no, definitely. I think what we're seeing is clients that are now, as I alluded to earlier, they're finding themselves not able to get all the solution from one place. So where they might have wanted that turnkey solution, that's really hard to come by. So as they diversify and as they bring some of that skill set in-house, which is increasingly the case, they can easily identify the gaps, but they don't need a big corporation to fill those gaps. They can find individuals, they can find consortiums or small micro agencies, as you say, that can step in and fill those gaps really, really easily. So more and more I'm finding myself, partnering with small agencies or other one-man bands and small media outlets to kind of put together what would effectively look like an agency in terms of job titles.
Yeah.
But we're all coming at it from different angles.
Yeah, really interesting. It's going to be interesting to watch this space, I think, and see, whether this changes corporate engagement in the long term.
Yeah, look, and I think, it's really interesting. You talk about advertising agencies, which obviously I can do easily. When you talk about big advertising agencies, they're not that big anymore.
No.
They haven't been big for a long time. So, there'll be a few big agency reputations around town that have really only got like 10 or 20 people working for them.
Mm.
So, it's quite easy to compete on some level. Obviously, they've got resource behind them and they've got time and history with them. So, you know, that is an advantage. But for the rest of us, it's like, well, we can slot into those gaps quite easily.
Yeah.
And as I said, we're not paying big multinational overheads, so we can also do it at a different price bracket.
Exactly. And flexibility point too, probably.
Oh, 100%, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. How much time would you say you're now spending on acquiring new work versus implementing or doing the work?
That's a good question. I'd say pre-COVID, we probably would have been 30 to 40% getting new business in, doing tenders, doing all that sort of stuff. I'd say now we're in this period of time, I'd say it's probably more like 10% trying to get new business in.
Mm. Okay.
So, yeah, it's you know, that's a manageable figure. Any more than that, and of course it becomes hard to make a good profit.
Yes. That's quite a big change. Is that due to maybe less tenders being out there or less work as a whole, or do you think that – is there something else at play?
I always have to be careful here. This always sounds a bit smug, and I don't know how to say it without sounding smug, but actually COVID's been really good for us as a business.
Mm.
I think what's come about – and the reason that's come about is because when you take marketing directors in their day-to-day lives – and the other variety of board level individuals we deal with, they're caught up in the day to day. There's a lot of stuff just happening and they're moving through. And yes, they'll engage us, but they'll engage us within a structure. What happened in COVID is they're all sat at home. They couldn't go and do those normal day to day things. They took them a bit of time to find their feet. But once they had, they kind of then went, well, what do I do with my time? Well, let me go to those bigger strategies, those bigger problems. And I can start to tackle them. Well, as they did, that's perfect for us. That's where we slot in quite often.
Yes.
So we were finding clients, not only the ones that obviously had to pivot because of COVID and they were having to change their product, and that was gave us quite a few clients in that space, but also just simple clients who found they had a different type of time on their hands that just seemed to work with engaging us to do what we do.
Yeah, definitely. I've definitely heard more about that as well in terms of I think people have either been super busy pivoting, maybe, you know, getting their e-commerce up and running faster than they were going to, or they've turned to these longer term projects that perhaps had not been able to get the focus to keep them moving and moving faster throughout this period. So, yeah, I can definitely see how that would be of benefit.
Yeah, there was a lot that had no choice, obviously. Mm. There was quite a few clients that we already had beforehand. That were either on a very slow journey to digital or one on one at all.
Yes.
Who just found themselves with little or no choice but to either pivot or you know, struggle. So I'd have to say on the whole, most of them embraced it wholeheartedly and just cracked on with it. And we did some incredible stuff that would have normally been a 6-month roadmap. We did one that was a 6-month roadmap and we achieved it in 22 days. So
wow.
Yeah. It's surprising what you can do when you have to, right?
Yeah, is that what it is, or was it being nimble and being able to, you know, move and action faster? What do you think? I mean, that's a pretty massive change.
Definitely in that particular case, the fact that the organization themselves just they put a team on it, they focused 100% on achieving that, where it would have been a part of a lot of people's roles.
Yes.
It became all of a large number of people's roles. So that pressure and desire to get it done. And just the decision-making. I mean, we were making decisions in the morning and having the product rolled out in the afternoon. You know, that never happens in normal processes. That would have definitely been a few meetings, you know, a board-level decision, a few papers going back and forth, probably a couple of weeks.
That's right.
And you're talking that down to a couple of hours. So it'll be interesting to see if any of that sticks. I don't think this is the one I keep coming back to in my head, is like how much of this is going to now become the norm. You're certainly seeing that with people working from home, right? I've already got a few clients who are saying they can go back to the office, but the mandate is not to go back to the office.
Yes, so. Yes, definitely. Yeah. Watch this space, hey?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, keep the term that keeps bantering around is the new normal, right? Don't really know what it looks like just yet.
But. No, exactly. And I don't think we will for a while, actually. It's going to keep evolving. So what would you say has been the hardest thing so far in making this transition for you?
I think as much as I've run multiple companies, I've always had the luxury of there were multinationals and I had an accounting team and I had a finance team and I had a account management team. And the fact that you suddenly have to take on so many of those roles.
Yes.
And just the complexity of just setting up and running a business. I mean, you know, I know small business people always talk about it, but in reality, you know, doing the books, keeping on top of admin, understanding fun, taxes, you know, it's like that alone is a full-time job, right? When you're starting out, I think I've got a handle on it at the moment. So I think we're okay. We've kind of settled back down again, but in the early days, that is tough.
Yeah.
It's a really tough gig.
Yeah, definitely.
And understanding the huge difference between large corporate finance and small business finance, which there is little connection between them, to be honest.
Yeah, that's right. And getting the right support around you and systems in place, definitely, you know, it's easy to spend loads of time on all that stuff when you're starting, isn't it?
Yeah, and you do, and like I think we had at one point we span up the Xero project management software, you know, which,
yep.
And then I realized that it was taking me longer to do the project management software than it was to do the project. it got turned off pretty quick. So like, I think just stuff like that, on the surface, it would seem to be the right way to do things. And until you find your stride and understand what it is you're doing.
Yes.
Stuff doesn't work. And we're lucky in the fact that most of our projects are reasonable sized, you know, they're usually, you know, shortest engagement is probably 3-4 weeks.
Yeah.
So it's not like I'm having to do a like some poor guys do when they're just churning through millions and millions and millions of invoices and stuff.
Yeah, that's right. Not more
still,
micro,
you know,
invoices.
Complicated enough.
How did you, that brings up an interesting point actually. How did you decide on your pricing for this? I mean, obviously coming out of agency world, there's probably different expectations around pricing. Did you kind of set your aim around that, and has it had to change over the way? What's been your experience?
Look, there's no doubt having a good inside knowledge of what agencies charge was paramount. I also went out to a few of ex-clients that I've known and sort of who ironically didn't become clients of the agency. They're just friends.
Yeah.
And so it's like, what do you need this to be to make it viable? Because it's like, it's sounding less and less viable.
Yeah.
And they were valuable conversations because they were then, well, actually, it's not so much the price point. It's the fact that there's no vested interest in outcome. So for a lot of our clients now, we still do projects on hourly rates. We still do projects on, you know, project costs. But we're also doing projects on outcome. Because, you know, the marketer at the end of the day, that's what they have to do. They have to prove the outcome. If you can put skin in the game and kind of go, well, look, we'll join you on that journey. And the outcome matters to us as much as it matters to you. Not only does that build a very different relationship as you're going through the projects, but it makes us focus on what needs to be focused on and keep an eye on what needs to be done.
Great.
So I think we've got a very different model in that respect.
What does that practically look like, Rob, to kind of work alongside a customer like that? Like, how do you arrange that, you know, set up?
Well, look, pre-COVID, it was very much we come and live with them. Like we would kind of like, you know, we work out of a small office. So, you know, it's pretty nice to actually get out and work in corporate spaces. So certainly two or three of our bigger clients, we camp with them. So we would sit in their department, as so often is the case with the consultancy model anyway. And that proves massive in benefits in the fact that you are part of the conversations as they're happening. There's no briefing moment. You can stop work on something if it's apparently obvious in the last 10 minutes that it's not going to be necessary anymore. All the stuff that actually means you're more cost effective anyway, because you're actually across the board. Post COVID, that's just been a lot more check-ins, part of their team check-ins and their campfires, and just being there and being front and center with them. And then helping them with more often than not, helping with things like board papers and how that gets represented up to gets represented up to higher levels of the organization.
And again, that
makes you kind of part of the team because you understand the pressures on them.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. Much more insight. And when you've worked with clients, when you have partnered on the outcome, does that mean that you maybe get a bonus based on performance, or that you alter your pricing, or how does that look?
Yeah, usually you put a bit at risk. So effectively, you know, you have to kind of cover costs. You can't ever put the whole thing at risk. But what we tend to do is kind of say, well, actually, this is raw costs to the business. We're very transparent. We share, you know, there's zero markup on externals and stuff with us. So we kind of can be completely transparent.
Yep.
And therefore we lay out the situation in front of the client and go, this is the bit that this is where we would make our profit effectively. We'll put that at risk with you. And so if it doesn't work, you know, we just cover costs. And on the whole, most clients, you know, it's not like clients don't think you're going to make profit or indeed are not willing for you to make profit.
No.
As long as it's within a, you know, sensible parameters, then everyone's totally in agreement. But it also means, you know, to a certain extent, it also means if you're making decisions, you're making decisions that are, because they're going to impact you more, you tend to spend longer thinking about them.
Yeah, that's true. Definitely. Excellent. Now, what advice would you give to someone else who is has maybe just recently left a corporate role and is thinking, I want to jump into this. I want to be consulting in my specialized area. What would you suggest they do first up and what general advice would you have for them?
Look, before you, I think first and foremost, before you make that jump, make sure you have a special area. Make sure that there is a marketplace for what you're trying to sell. I also think, you know, there's no harm in building up some network and testing some waters before you make the jump. And then obviously in current circumstances, some people have no choice. I mean, they're not making the jump. The jump is being designed for them. It's a tough time out there to do it right now because, as I've just said, you know, there's a huge amount of people moving into this space right now. And then, you know, find yourself a couple of keynote clients if you can. You know, find those first flagship clients before you step out. And then once you've got one or two, it's amazing how the rest come. They just seem to, you know, every time we kind of go, oh, we're down to, you know, five or six active projects, the phone rings, more arrive. It's kind of seemingly. So it does happen. Stay active in the space, stay active in your networks. Don't get consumed so much by one project that you disappear for 6 months doing it.
Yeah, that's right.
Certainly seen that, you know, we've had a few offers where people said, oh, look, we can come and do this project for 6 months and, you know, do nothing else. And that's, we've had to sort of go, well, we'll do the project, but we'll put a couple of people on it. We won't dive 100% into it because then you disappear and everyone thinks you've kind of either got a job or given up.
So yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's a really good point.
You've got to be a little bit careful of that exposure.
Yeah, because I guess in the early days that can sound almost too good to be true to start off with, but there is an opportunity cost, I suppose, of doing that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, 100%. And some of those are partnerships as well, where you've, again, you've got to be careful of that because, you know, we do partnerships. We have a few of them, but none of them are to the point where people say, oh, you know, Rob now works for us part-time. Well, you can't do that because you've got to, how you're going to keep your business is your focus. So, you know, don't allow that to happen. They're very tempting in the early days because you think, oh, that's good. I've got some reliable income.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
But, you know, as a brand strategist, the first thing is focus on that brand and make sure it works and make sure it's kind of the first thing you think about when these things come along.
Definitely. Well, thank you so much for sharing all your experience on this today, Rob. It's been really great to delve into this topic with you and to see some of your learnings along the way. If people want to get in touch with you, what's the best way for them to find you?
Well, LinkedIn obviously is a pretty quick way to find us. So just look up Rob Hudson on LinkedIn or just go to the website. All the contact details are on there. So it's just spoutlogic.com.
Perfect. We'll definitely link to those in the show notes as well. Thanks again for being on the podcast.
Absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thanks for listening. If you liked this episode, please remember to subscribe. My recommended action item from today's show is to connect with Rob Hudson on LinkedIn. He's a great guy to know. Don't forget to stop by the Interactive Minds Facebook group where hundreds of marketers have discussions, answer questions, and I share the latest news I'm seeing in the industry. You can access today's show notes at interactiveminds.com/podcast. Thanks for listening.